Good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Our first item of business today is a decision to take item 5 in private. Are we all agreed? Agreed. Thank you very much. Our agenda item number 2 is looking at the medium-term financial strategy and framework for resource spending. And we have our consideration of the two financial planning documents, the medium-term financial strategy and the resource spending review framework. And I welcome to the meeting Emma Congreve, who's from the Knowledge Executive Exchange Fellowship of the Fraser Valander Institute, and David Phillips, Associate Director of the Institute for Fiscal Studies. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. Both of you are joining us remotely. Members do have a lot of interest in these two areas and a lot of questions, so I'm going to move directly to questions. And questions on theme 1, we have round about the risk to the budget from Social Security. And I'm going to bring in my colleague Natalie Dawn first, who joins us remotely, and then we will go to Miles Briggs, who's in the room. Natalie, please.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. My first question, can you advise what extent the demand-led nature of Social Security represents as a risk to the Scottish budget as a whole, please? Sorry, I should say I'll direct that question to Emma first. Thank you.
Of course. Good morning.
Morning.
So there are different risks that come with Social Security forecasting. And I mean, one of the issues that I found whilst reading through both of the documents was an understanding of whether there was a good understanding communicated over those different risks and where they stem from. So in terms of demand changes, because most of the Social Security measures that exist in the Scottish budget relate to what we usually term as a sort of additional cost benefits for people with disabilities or caring responsibilities. I mean, they do tend to be quite stable over time. They tend to shift with demographic changes, which, you know, are relatively easy to sort of predict going forward. So they don't tend to pose a huge risk if all else is held equal. Of course, if eligibility is changed, then caseload will change and so demand changes in that way. But it's not that's within the control of the Scottish Government, I suppose. Whereas you think about factors out with the control of the Scottish Government, changes in characteristics of the population and their caseload and caseload changes as a result are more important. But as I say, the bulk of Social Security measures in Scotland are on those measures that tend to be fairly stable. The exception being the Scottish Child Payment, which is a relatively small chunk of Social Security spending, I guess, if you look at it as a whole. But that will also depend on people's incomes and therefore can fluctuate with the economic cycle. And therefore, caseload can change, you know, quite short notice, as we have experienced over the past few years. So that's a factor much less within the control of the Scottish Government. But that's just one part of the overall basket of Social Security. As I say, on the whole, it's the demand fluctuations aren't as much of a risk as for Scotland as they are potentially for the UK, where they have more of the means tested benefits under their control.
Thank you. I think that David wants to come in as well, Natalie.
Thanks.
I would agree very much with what Emma was saying. Sort of when we reach a sort of steady state with the new Scottish Social Security benefits, because these are sort of linked to health conditions in the main, those things tend to be more stable and linked to demographics. And over time, somewhat, you know, changes in expectations about what the benefit system can offer and what counts as a disability. But those things tend to change over time. I think there is potentially a significant risk at this point in time as the benefits are rolled out. And that's because there's a sort of uncertainty about how the benefits are going to be implemented in practice, given the changes to the process for how eligibility is assessed, the changes in culture at Scottish Social Security compared to DWP. And for example, we saw when they were rolling out PIP in UK as a whole, there were expectations that would lead to a significant, you know, reduction in spending. In fact, that didn't take place. And, you know, spending was kind of progressively revised up. Now, I think the Scottish Fiscal Commission has sort of built in an expectation that the kind of system will lead to, you know, more people claiming, more people being successful in their claims, and a higher average claim amount. But there's a lot of uncertainty around that. We'll come on to it in a bit, but the documents do set out some scenarios around, you know, lower and upper scenarios. I think the lower might be kind of, you know, really unrealistic, given these are almost certainly going to kind of push up demand and cost relative to the UK system, because more people will be deemed eligible. But that can give a sort of sense that there is some risk in this initial phase. Once it reaches a steady state, I think there's somewhat less risk, very much for the reasons that Emma was saying.
Thank you. I mean, you touched on it. Obviously, the Scottish Government are encouraging the take-up of benefits, so I think that leads to an increased potential risk. But I know that you've said it's more an issue in the short term. How do you feel that these risks might be managed? Do you think that the UK Government could do more to alleviate any potential risks by ensuring that our funding won't reduce regardless of any policy decisions that are taken by Westminster? Can I put that? I'll go back to David, sorry, and then I'll come to Emma after. Thanks, if you've got anything to add.
So I think the short answer to that is no, I don't think that would be appropriate. The reason being that UK-wide benefits are funded, you know, through UK-wide taxes. And for example, if a decision is taken in Westminster to reduce the generosity of a UK-wide benefit, that is less tax revenues, you know, being used to fund benefits in Wales, Scotland, Wales, England, and Northern Ireland. Now, the impact of that on Scotland, you might say, well, that's unfair. Why are we getting less spend on benefits ourselves? Well, it's because either less is being spent in total on England, Scotland, and Northern Ireland from UK-wide taxes, and Scotland has to, if you like, for reasons of fairness, share in that reduction in spending, or spending is going to be reallocated to other areas from which Scotland will benefit. For example, health spending, where Scotland gets a share by the Barnett formula, or reserve benefits, where Scotland gets a share. So I think that if there are changes in benefit policy in the rest of the UK, the way our funding system works, where that money comes from a pooled pot, Scotland has to make a contribution to that as well. Now, I think what this is showing, though, is that under the current system, there is limited sort of flexibility for Scotland to respond to those sorts of changes. So Scotland does have devolved tax powers, and, you know, it's a reasonable suggestion to say, well, if Scotland wants to spend more on a certain area and not cut elsewhere, taxation is a natural area to look. And we have seen the Scottish Government make use of those tax powers. But in the short term, you know, it's difficult to make changes in the short term. The UK Government hasn't got to do that if costs change, if funding availability changes. It can borrow in the short term to cover that. And I think we have identified, you know, both sort of, you know, a need for higher borrowing to address forecast errors, which, you know, can happen not just because of changes in policy in the rest of the UK, but as I said, you know, the difficulty in forecasting the cost of Scottish benefits. Currently, there's quite strong constraints on how much Scotland can borrow, even to address forecast errors. I think there's a case to say those limits should be substantially increased, potentially even abolished, because the forecast error itself is like a limit on how much you can borrow. Also, you know, I think in the sort of short to medium term, discretionary borrowing, again, perhaps actually with a limit on this, so that the Scottish Government can borrow even if it's not a forecast error, to address in the short term, smooth the impacts of these sorts of changes. So that may be not kind of the kind of exact answer you're looking for exactly, but I guess what I'm saying is that there needs to be kind of sharing across the UK. There needs to be kind of a system that is fair across the whole of the UK, but there also needs to be kind of a system to give flexibility to the Scottish Government to respond, you know, over time by potentially reprioritising spending, raising taxes or changing welfare, not having to respond immediately as the block grant changes.
Thanks, David. No, it's very informative. Not specifically looking for an answer, just looking for the facts. So thank you, David. Emma, sorry, I'm not sure if you have anything to add. Thanks.
Just very briefly, I mean, I do agree with much of what David has said there, with potentially the focus on Westminster kind of changes to help Scotland manage it, probably best focused on issues around the fiscal framework and borrowing, rather than in terms of there being, you know, other guards put in to safeguard Scotland if spending changes in for the rest of the UK. I think that principle of these, particularly where these we've got the division of devolved benefits on disability and carers now, I think that they need to operate within that devolved space without, as many other policies do. I think where there's a bit of a grey area between them is the way where we're using reserve benefits as passports for top-up benefits in Scotland. I think sometimes there, I'm not sure if we'll see this, but say, you know, the systems for eligibility for universal credit were eased and more people came into the system, then that would have a knock-on effect on benefits in Scotland, a Scottish child payment anyway. So I think there's a conversation to be thought about there, but in principle, I think the borrowing area is the right place to think about in terms of helping Scotland manage risks around social security.
Thank you both. Back to the convener.
Thanks very much for that, Natalie. I'll hand over to Miles Briggs, and then after that, Pam Duncan-Glancy. Miles.
Thank you. Thank you, convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us. I wanted to further develop some of the points which my colleague Natalie Dawn had pursued there, because I wanted to ask specifically when Dame Susan Rice from the Scottish Fiscal Commission had come to committee, you know, she outlined in quite stark terms the fact that the gap is set to reach £750 million by 2024-25. So, you know, this is very much on the horizon now for budgeting. So I just wondered, to follow on that line of questioning, where the financial management is actually within the Scottish Government around that. Where are you seeing that future projection being costed into proposals? We obviously, each budget year, are voting on that and seeing increasing levels going towards social security, but that is a huge amount of money. And as Dame Rice says, that money must be found from elsewhere in the Scottish budget. So what work is going on, which you're aware of how that will be financially managed in the future? Maybe put that to Emma and then David, if you want to come in.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, so we would expect there to be divergences in policy and spend with that's kind of what devolution's about. It's that ability to make different choices on spend. And hence we are seeing that with social security, particularly as David mentioned earlier, and partly related to sort of a different approach to sort of applications and a different culture that's trying to be brought in, which is expected to lead to increasing spend, but also there have been policy changes, which also are part of the reason why spend is expected to be higher. So in terms of how that will be managed, I mean, it's a similar principle to how any, you know, additional spend is managed within the budget, and the spending review process is really key here, because that's where we would expect to see how different areas of spend are being prioritised and where reductions are being made in order to spend more on things like social security, where commitments have already been made to increase spend. The really important thing, which we are seeing, is that there's this modelling, which is telling us, you know, from the Scottish Fiscal Commission what these projected areas of spend are going to be. And I would expect within the Scottish Government, they are also, you know, doing their own shadow forecasting so that when they do, they are thinking about any future changes, they are able to cost that in as well, you know, whilst they're kind of making their plans. So I would expect, and of course, the Scottish Fiscal Commission have said they will do some forecasts for the spending review as well. So this will be all part of that process internally. I mean, when we're thinking about how the framework document has been set out and how some of the priorities there have been kind of talked about, clearly there are quite a number of priorities that the government are putting forward. You know, hard to agree on child poverty, climate change and the economy has been very, very important. But within all of that, if you are prioritising areas of spend, and when overall there is understood to be a shortfall between funding and spending for the you know, spending review period as a whole, there will have to be decisions made on where to reduce spend or to increase it at less than real terms. So, I mean, very much expecting that the spending review will answer those questions. I mean, it really must, and so that got that that understanding over the medium term as to, you know, what the trade-offs actually are in spending more on one area, you will have to spend less on another, or taxation will need to increase. So so that's my understanding of what will be happening at the moment in terms of thinking those things through.
Thank you for that. And David, before I bring you in, I'll maybe expand the question a little bit. From your experience, which budgets are therefore likely to be targeted? You know, we've seen a budget which has cut £120 million from local government. Is the NHS budgets, for example, which have increased above inflation every year of this Parliament's been established, to be able to look towards that budget? And where do you think ministers particularly will look to find this money?
Thank you. Well, on the kind of first question you answered, and I'll come on to the second part in a second. On the first part, again, I would agree with Emma. I expect the spending review to set out the kind of choices the Scottish government is making on how to prioritise its spending. It will be a difficult spending review, you know, based on sort of not only the kind of underlying pressures, you know, due to, you know, demands and costs for existing public services back, but, you know, there's a few things sort of coming down the line. There's the welfare spending measures, the social security spending measures, which you say add up to about £750 million by the end of the period. There's the sort of relative underperformance of Scottish income tax revenues, bringing down on the revenue side, and some sort of negative reconciliations coming down the way. So it will be a difficult spending review period, as Emma was saying there. I would perhaps say that, you know, one would hope that when these policies were initially being formulated, that even though there wasn't a spending review at that point, some assessment of what the likely funding environment would be like down the line was being made, and a decision about the you know, the potential knock-on effects given that environment for other parts of the budget was considered at that point. Now, it's not clear to me whether that was the case or not, but I certainly think that is something that the Scottish Government should be asked about, and what planning was done around that when these promises and these plans are really being put in place. You can't just say, well, we're going to have a spending review later down the line once these things are already in place, already in the system, because then the only option is to kind of cut back other areas or, you know, go back on your promises. I think even if you don't do the full review, there should still be some analysis at that earlier stage. So that could be a potential area to ask the Scottish Government about. On your second question about which areas to cut, well, I think the challenges here are that commitments have been made not just on social security, but other areas, for example. So underlying the spending review framework and the medium-term financial strategy is an assumption, for example, that health spending was up 3.5% a year. That is substantially less than we required to meet the Scottish Government's commitment to pass on in full the NHS consequentials coming as a result of decisions in Westminster. That makes it difficult to actually cut spending on NHS compared to what's in the forecast. Actually, you want to spend more to meet your pledges on health spending than what's in those current forecasts. There are obviously concerns around education standards in Scotland at the moment, and that might make it difficult to cut back on school spending. With health and schools taken out of the picture, you're left with kind of a fairly small pot to cut back. And that could then mean some of the areas that have seen big cuts already over the years, you know, local government, housing, transport, the environment, culture, policing, and so on, justice, those areas see further cuts. Or, you know, one has to go back on one's pledges on health or social security, or look to taxation and increases in taxation to make up some of the gap.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Karina.
Thank you very much. I'll now go to Pam Duncan-Glancy and then Jeremy Balfour after that. Pam.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for the information you gave us in advance. It was really helpful, and thank you for your answers so far. I have a couple of questions around risk and demand within the social security system. I guess my first one is probably for Emma, if that's okay, and it's around the point that the Scottish Government have policy to increase uptake in benefits. Is it clear from the framework and other documents how this is being considered, both in terms of how they would do it, the costs of it and the implications?
From the documents that are reviewing as part of the spending review and that came out in December, no, it's not particularly apparent how so specifically, you know, some of these areas will be developed. And I mean, I suppose I would say that maybe we wouldn't necessarily expect that kind of detailed consideration to be in these types of high level documents that came out at that time. We would expect them to be part of big policy frameworks such as the Child Poverty Delivery Plan, and indeed any frameworks that are produced in terms of take-up. What we would expect to see in the spending review is the sort of inclusion of any particular costs associated with that and if there are no costs associated with that, I suppose that's opens up a question as well. But yeah, certainly if that is a specific policy and there are cost implications of that, we would expect that to be part of financial information, detailed financial information, but not necessarily, as I would say, it was part of the documents that we're talking about today.
Thank you, that's really helpful. The government has indicated that it will review some of the eligibility criteria around the 20-metre rule this year, I think, or they'll begin that review. When would you expect to see some of the detail in terms of the costings for that? When should we be looking to see, what timescale should we be looking to see? I'm conscious of the answer that David gave around when you'd expect to see financial decisions as well as policy decisions. So it'd be good to know what you think about that.
I mentioned earlier that I think that the Scottish Government will be doing their own internal financial costings on this when these decisions are being considered. But in terms of when that information is in the public domain, I mean, that is now very much under the jurisdiction of the Scottish Fiscal Commission. So they will be the ones, once a policy, you know, is confirmed, and they will be looking for evidence that they can use to produce a robust costing of that. And that may be revised over time as better estimates come into being. But that's where we would be looking, I suppose, for what it's where we now are expected to look for that information in terms of the cost of policies. It's an interesting question as to what extent, as I say, would expect the Scottish Government to be considering these things as they are making these decisions, but there isn't an expectation necessarily that that information, you know, will be made public, because that's the role of the Scottish Fiscal Commission. So it's an interesting area, and it's something that I think it could be would be interesting to ask the Scottish Government about in terms of the planning and the work that they go through. Even if then they have to revise their figures as a result of the Scottish Fiscal Commission, you know, as has happened with things like the Scottish Child Payment in the past. But sorry, I hope that helps them in terms of that.
Thank you. It does. I guess I'm just getting at whether, you know, if the policy, if there's a review, and if they're serious about changing it, I'd like to know that the money was there, or where they were going to get the money, and how soon we should expect detail on that. So that is helpful. The other questions I have perhaps are for both of you. The Cabinet Secretary said that she wants to make intelligent decisions on social security. Could you set out how that could be done, and whether or not you think the government have the data to do that, what the timescales involved in intelligent decision-making on social security should be, kind of related to the point that we've just spoke about?
I can start and then pass to David. So far, in terms of decisions being made on social security, there has been a lot of it has taken a lot of time to decide what changes to be made. Clearly, these are areas that affect a lot of people quite substantially, and therefore we have seen a lot in terms of consultation and talking with the panels. In terms of understanding what the issues with the system as it was before and what could improve that in the future. In terms of data, that will always be difficult. For any policy that is increasing eligibility, and I would say this is particularly the case in terms of some areas around ill health and disability, in that I don't think in Scotland, and this is based on work I've done on the social care system, we don't have a very good grasp on levels of unmet need, and therefore it's quite hard to know how many people would, you know, come under a policy if eligibility was increased, and indeed, you know, for looking at the National Care Service, if eligibility was increased for access to services. So I think data is an issue in terms of being able to understand that impact, and if you don't have that, it's quite difficult to estimate costs in the future. So what we do see is a lot of reference back to the UK system, and hence in the MTFS they use forecasts. Forecast error between OBR and forecasts, and then outturn, to kind of determine where the extent of divergence in figures over time. But is that really applicable to the situation in Scotland? Maybe not, but it's difficult to know where else you go to find that kind of intelligent information. So there is a lot of uncertainty here. But it's unavoidable to a large extent, and I don't know if that should guard against making changes, or changes should be more cautious over time, and so that you get small incremental changes to get to the end goal, so you have a bit more financial certainty over what's happening. But I'm not sure that would be acceptable necessarily to the wider public, or to those who, you know, are potentially in scope for increased benefits over time. But yeah, it's a very interesting question.
David, did you want to ask?
Yes, thanks very much. So I would agree with lots of what Emma was saying there. I think that over time, as there is more information about the impacts of the changes that have been made so far and the ability of the Scottish Fiscal Commission to forecast those that should, you know, reduce but not eliminate uncertainty. And as Emma was saying, that I think there is sort of a bit of a trade-off in the short to medium term about the extent to which one goes slower in order to, you know, avoid adding further to the uncertainty and the potential of a kind of major forecast errors that would, you know, potentially cause a hole in the Scottish Government's budget, and wanting to kind of move quickly to, you know, address, you know, legitimate policy concerns that people have with the current systems. I'd also add that I think that there are differences for different types of, you know, policy measures. So, for example, you know, estimating the cost of changes to changes in benefit rates is much more straightforward than estimating the cost of changes to the eligibility criteria and the assessment process. When looking at kind of things like means-tested benefits, like the Scottish Child Payment, again, data on things like income is generally a lot better than data on things like health, which is sort of more subjective. The main risk for things like Scottish Child Payment is not so much kind of modelling eligibility for these benefits. It would be cyclicality, how those things go up and down in sort of recessions and booms, but also take-up. What will the take-up rate be, and how does the take-up rate particularly vary as you change the generosity benefits? We know from existing research that take-up is higher, the higher the benefit is, because obviously it makes more, you know, sort of rational sense to kind of invest the time and effort in claiming a benefit that is worth more. So I think there's different risks and different challenges for different policies. I think once, again, as I said, the sort of first question, once kind of a system is in place that we think, or that the Scottish Government and people think that, you know, is largely appropriate structurally in the way it's working, the subsequent changes, which tend to be things about benefit rates, those are things that can be, you know, forecast a lot more straightforwardly and planned a lot more easily. And I would again come back to my kind of point that, you know, we might come on to this a bit later. I do think in some respects these two documents talk a little bit too much about the fiscal framework review and not enough about kind of policies in Scotland with the current kind of fiscal powers. But I think the fiscal framework is an important kind of constraint here as well. If you had, you know, greater ability to borrow to address forecast errors, you'd be a bit more relaxed about there being forecast errors and being able to make policies that you might get, you know, the cost wrong. Without those forecasts, you know, with constrained borrowing powers, you need to think more about that potential forecast errors, because if they arise and they exceed the borrowing limits, you either need to draw down reserves or cut back other spending or raise taxes to address them, which is, you know, harder to do.
That's really helpful. Can I ask one follow-up? One more follow-up, convener?
If it's very short.
It will be short.
We can have short answers.
thank you. Thanks. That's really, really helpful. It's noted that there's not much information about how the social security system can address demand. And in the context you've just set out, prevention and the way it interacts with other services seems to be quite important. Could you briefly set out why it's important, what the implications are, and what you'd expect to see?
That.
Probably both, but I won't need a question later if that helps for time.
Great. Start with Emma maybe, and then David.
Yeah, I'm happy to start on that. I think that's a really interesting question, because prevention is mentioned quite a few times particularly in the framework, but there's not too much then made of what the potential implications of that are. So social security is part of a bigger, you know, system in terms of public services, and, you know, increasing support in one area may therefore have a reduction in others, potentially over quite a short time period. And I'm particularly thinking about the interactions between the social care system and particularly carers allowance. So I think there are some potential implications there that I would hope would be picked up and looked at more in a spending review. Rather than just prevention being mentioned, it needs to be analysed.
David, do you have anything to add to that?
Yes, I would add one kind of further point. I agree with what Emma was saying. The point I would add as well is that what I would hope departments don't just rely on is that these sort of preventative services, the justification for them is that you save money down the line. That is part of the justification for investing in earlier intervention and preventative services. But actually, when research looks at a lot of preventative services, so for example, say the impact of investment on social care or children's social services on subsequent costs for healthcare, what the evidence suggests is that it was a reduction in the cost of healthcare from the increase in spending on children's social services or adult social services, but that it's not enough to offset the extra spending. But that doesn't mean that extra spending on children's social services and adult social services, wasn't good value for money or was a bad idea, because you're not just kind of paying to kind of reduce spending elsewhere, you're paying for the outcomes and the improvements in quality of life and other things that come from that spending. And I've said this to kind of, MHCLG or whatever it's called now, DLUC in Westminster. When making a case to the Treasury, the value for money and the cost savings can be part of it, but it really needs to be about the broader benefits and value of these spending items. Otherwise, the Treasury men or the Scottish Treasury men and women with their sort of, hard-nosed attitude to this, we'll see through that and say, well, actually, no, we don't think this will kind of save us money. Make the broader case that this is a good thing to invest in more broadly.
Thank you very much for that, David. I think that was really helpful to set that out in the way that you've done. Jeremy Balfour's had his question on this theme answered, so I'm going to move to my colleague Faisal Chowdhury, and then we'll move to Emma Roddick after that. Faisal.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I've got a couple of questions. I think I'll direct the question to Emma first. How much will the other budget line be affected by increases in social security spendings?
So generally, how much of an impact does increase in social security have elsewhere? Is that
correct? Yeah.
Is that just to clarify the question? Yeah. It does. You invest more in one area, and there is a consequential need for either increased funding from taxation or from a reduction elsewhere in that kind of very short-term analysis. Over time, and David has, set out that these things aren't the be-all and end-all, but there are potential for preventative savings over time. So it's not necessarily a zero-sum game, but there will always be trade-offs for policy decisions. And I think the important thing from a scrutiny perspective is to understand the rationale for why increases in expenditure made in one area, and crucially, understanding the rationale for where spending has been reduced, and to check that there has been, a full consideration of the impact of reductions in spending as well as increases.
My next question is, isn't there a risk that budget cuts are a false economy? How do you assess the risk that they will just put more people into the social security system?
I think that's a very relevant point as well. And that's why I kind of mentioned specifically about there being an assessment of the impact of spending cuts in other areas. And so if you're reducing public services as a result of cutting local government spend, for example, then that might mean that people are, less likely to get, say, support to improve employability or financial security in terms of having support services for access to benefits in the community. And that might increase their reliance in the future in terms of some of the means-tested benefits and potentially if it leads to health impacts in terms of mental health, then it could have very long-term impacts on public spend. So I think it's an important point, and it's you know, a process of sort of salami slicing off different budgets in order to get to the right number is very dangerous in terms of, you know, impacts on people and there being those unintended consequences that you're referring to.
I think that David wants to come in on that point as well, Faisal.
Hi. Yes, thank you very much. Again, I keep saying this, I agree a lot with what Emma is saying there. I wanted to kind of come back to the kind of your first question, maybe add a kind of couple extra points on that. So, you know, I think the £750 million sort of gap between the block grant adjustment for social security and the forecast for actual spending, that's about 1.5 to 2%, I think, of the Scottish Government's resource budget. Now, that might not sound, you know, a huge amount, but actually when you kind of look at it compared to individual budgets, you know, to kind of put a scale on things, you know, it's about, you know, 4% of the health budget, you know, maybe 6-7% of the local government budget. Finding that amount of money is going to be, you know, challenging, especially given the other spending pressures that are faced. You know, so I think there will really need to be, you know, difficult decisions made around prioritisation. And I think the Scottish Government may need to look at taxation if it's serious about funding both welfare measures and addressing the pressures in other areas. Indeed, in the longer term, I think the UK Government needs to be serious about looking at taxation again, because, you know, to kind of quote a song, the only way is up when it comes to public spending in the next decades, given the ageing population and demographic change and rising cost pressures. There are choices you can make about, you know, not meeting all those pressures, but, you know, you need to make a choice. Either you put taxes up or you don't meet all the pressures coming down the line. On the kind of second point, I'd again agree that, you know, salami slicing is not the way to do it. And what I'd hope the Scottish Government is doing in the spending review is, as far as possible, you know, looking at right down to individual programme levels, you know, what is the sort of values programmes, both what is the value in terms of saving money. As I said, in general, most spending areas don't save money elsewhere, but some will. Some will have very high returns. But also the wider value to things, you know. So even if it's not saving money, is it very valuable for the impact on families, communities, the economy, you know, so on and so forth? So I think that is what I hope is being done. I think one of the things that the government will be doing is asking departments to kind of scenario plan around, well, what would you cut if you had to make a 5% cut or, you know, 2% cut to your budget, to kind of get departments to kind of, if you like, flush out their own sort of ideas for kind of where they could, you know, best make cuts. But that's all I wanted to kind of add on that kind of question.
Thank you, Convener. My last question to both of you, I guess. Should the Minister be open and publish what budget cuts are being foreseen to pay for further social security spending?
I can start on that. I mentioned this previously. I think it has to be part of the spending review, but seen in the round. I mean, social security is not the only area where there will be prioritisation of spend, you know, given what the framework document says about particularly child poverty, which I know will have social security implications, also sort of climate change. There will need to be openness and transparency about what those priorities for spend mean elsewhere, especially when there is a big gap between expected expenditure, expected funding. So I wouldn't say necessarily I'd expect that to be explicitly saying what is being cut to pay for social security, but it will be what is being you know, cut or what is being changed in order to pay for all of the new spending priorities that come through.
Thank you. And briefly, could we have your thoughts, David?
Yeah, I'll be very brief. So I would completely agree with that. I actually would go a bit further and say, I think it'd be actually unhelpful to try to say which areas are being cut specifically for social security, because the budget is a budget as a whole. Money is fungible. And saying that such an area is being cut to fund social security, you could just easily say such an area is being cut to fund another priority area. And in fact, the temptation might be for you know, government to sort of say, well, it's been cut to fund this, or it's been cut to fund that. I actually think it's kind of better to do it in the round, as Emma was suggesting. Obviously, I think the government will, you know, emphasise more the areas that it's making increases than making cuts. But the document should at least, you know, outline where difficult choices are being made.
Thank you very much for that. I'll move to questions now from Emma Roddick, who joins us in the room, and then Maria McNair, who joins us remotely. Emma.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning both. On the topic of budget scrutiny, is it more important for us who are tasked with scrutinising social security to make use of the medium-term financial strategy than it is for other committees? I'll ask that to Emma.
So clearly there are particular issues, because we know already that there are already committed to spend which goes above and beyond the kind of the money being transferred through the fiscal framework for these areas. So I think it is a particular it's obviously quite apparent that there is that gap there. I mean, and the Scottish Fiscal Commission, in their evidence to you before Christmas, you know, were very able to be very explicit on that. But I mean, a couple of points. The first is that, again, you know, this, as I said before, we expect there to be divergence in policy between what was previously done under the reserved system and now what's being done under a dual system. You know, that's the whole point of the devolution. So I think getting too caught up into that gap as being, you know, the most important thing is probably not the right thing to focus on. I think it is much more about understanding how social security spend fits into the Scottish budget and how policy decisions going forward fits into that, and, you know, the funding coming from the UK, from Westminster, it forms part of that whole picture. It's not just about social security. But I do think there are particular issues that could have been made more of in the MTFS. I think I note a couple of them in the submission I gave. But things, I know you're coming to this later today in your session, but around inflation and uprating, that's obviously a key financial risk, around things like future policy changes and kind of understanding the appetite for that. And we know there's a consultation out on the replacement for carers allowance. So, you know, what changes might come down the line from that haven't been taken account of in these documents. So I do think it's definitely worth the committee scrutinising that and potentially making, asking some questions about what is and isn't included, and could more have been done to strengthen the understanding of the financial risks around social security. But I do think it's important for this committee, because it's an area where there are it's relatively easy to see those issues coming down the line years in advance.
Thank you for that. And going to your written submission, I did notice that you said there's relatively little analysis in the MTFS on social security outlook. Is the MTFS enough then for us, or should we be taking a more frequent and active monitoring role? And, you know, if so, how would we do that, particularly considering the current volatility?
I mean, the approach you've taken as a committee, you know, in hearing evidence from the Scottish Fiscal Commission and, you know, getting a fuller picture maybe than what's presented in the MTFS, I think it is probably necessary for you as a committee. I would, you know, potentially press the government to include more in the MTFS in future about social security. I mean, there was more probably in the framework document for the spending review than there was in the MTFS. So taking the two documents together, you do get a bit more insight into into what some of the pressures are and how some of the analysis has been put together that you don't get from looking at the MTFS on its own. But I think there are improvements that can be made to that document. But certainly, I think where there are clearly things that aren't explicitly addressed or unmentioned, I think more kind of scrutiny of the government and ministers on that is appropriate.
Thank you.
Thanks for that, Emma. I'll now move to questions from Marie McNair and then after that, Miles Briggs. Marie?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Happy St. Patrick's Day to you. With regards to the connection with the economy and other budgets, you touched on this answer to my colleague Pam Duncan-Glancy, but practically it would be good to hear more. Is there anything like this happening at UK level to embed the link? And there's a good practice and experience, etc., that, you know, an approach of this in any other countries that you're aware of?
And who would you direct
Sorry,
me to?
Sorry, that's posted to Emma, and maybe David could add to that.
Can I just clarify the question? So that's in relation to linking social security to sort of other areas of the budget?
Yes, because obviously in reference to your written submission, you make the connection, the social security spend to the wider economy and the public spending is missed. And you gave an example that investment in social security had potential to reduce NHS and social care spend. So just wanted you to expand a bit on that, if you could.
Yeah, so I will let David answer about the rest of the UK. But my comments on that were kind of, you know, very much with Scotland and the sort of Christie Commission in mind in terms of how we talk about prevention a lot as being quite as a critical pillar, I suppose, of policy making in Scotland. And, you know, we in pretty much every government document, you will see the words prevention mentioned and how important prevention is. But rarely do we either A, see sort of analysis of what that, you know, means in practice. So in terms of where there are those kind of linkages being made and potentially because of that, we therefore don't see the monitoring and evaluation that would allow over time for us to understand, you know, how those linkages happen in practice. So in theory, you know, there's of course is a link between, you know, increasing the Scottish child payment, reducing child poverty, better educational outcomes in the future, better health outcomes in the future. But a lot of that is based on, not necessarily based on evidence from Scotland, a lot of that is based on kind of our understanding of logic and evidence from elsewhere. And I think it's really key in terms of thinking, you know, if prevention is a critical pillar of policymaking in Scotland, then we need to be much better evidencing that. And being, you know, better able to kind of make the case for that and to actually understand the extent to which we do have, we are able to prevent spend down the line and prevent poor outcomes down the line in terms of those kind of well-being issues as well. So that's, you know, why I've kind of honed in on that, because it is such a theme in Scotland, but it can be quite frustrating that it's talked about and then not always followed through in terms of the analysis.
Is there any good practice in other parts of the world on how the link is assessed?
I'm going to pass to David, see if he has any thoughts on that, and then I can come back in.
So I'll kind of answer it with my sort of academic economist hat on. So I think the challenge with kind of like really credibly showing the link is that, you know, you need to have a policy that is sort of rolled out in a way where you've got what we kind of call a treatment in the control group. You can kind of compare the outcomes, the behaviour for those that benefited from the policy from those that haven't benefited from the policy, and effectively can kind of compare the differences in outcomes. So you can kind of have a good idea, you know, what was the effect of the policy, as opposed to what were just other things going on in the background over time as a policy happened to be rolled out. Now, actually, there may be opportunities to do some of that in Scotland, given the kind of rollout by age group of children. Colleagues have looked at the impact of rolling out changes to the benefit system, actually in the other direction, where there was kind of requirements for lone parents of children of different ages to sort of seek work at younger and younger ages with their children and use that to look at the impact on mothers' employment using the phased rollout of these schemes. And actually, if there's a kind of phased rollout of the reduction in the age in which the children become eligible, or sorry, lose eligibility for these payments, it could be an opportunity to look at that, for example, for the child payment in Scotland. So, you know, I'm suggesting engage with academics in Scotland and elsewhere to kind of think about, can these policies be evaluated? The other point I wanted to kind of mention, I guess, kind of linking up, you know, social security policy to the economy. One thing that is often thought about at UK level is what is the impact of social security policy on working behaviour. Sometimes policies are made very much to incentivise work, for example, you know, things like the working tax credit, or, you know, reductions in the taper rate for universal credit, in-work retention bonuses and things like that. Other times, you know, work behaviour is seen as a potentially unintended consequence of changing social security, that, you know, you reduce incentives to go to work if benefits go up and there's more to lose from entering work. I mention that just because I think there is one area of benefits policy which over time might become a more significant disincentive for work because of the particular way it's designed. And there might be kind of options to reform the way it's designed. And that's the child payment. Scottish child payment is a cliff edge. When you lose eligibility for it, you lose eligibility in total. It's not tapered away. So you can earn an extra pound or two of income. And I think you then lose, my understanding is you lose the full amount of the Scottish child tax payment, which, you know, say if you had two children, you know, could be £40 when it's rolled out, three children, £60. That can act as a, you know, quite a strong disincentive for people taking a pay rise, working a couple extra hours. Reforming that, it'd be more complicated, but reforming that so that it's tapered rather than a cliff edge, that could be kind of a way to kind of maybe think about the interaction between benefits policy and impacts on economy and people's livelihoods in a sort of slightly different way.
Marie, do you have any further questions?
One final question. In their submission to us, the Scottish Fiscal Commission indicated that they had recruited several staff to begin work on the fiscal sustainability report, and this will cover the outlook for the Scottish Government's funding and spending plans over a kind of long time, horizons over like 30 years. Do you welcome this development, and do you think it will bring to the table that will, what do you think it will bring to the table that will assist with future budget settings? Again, if you can't respond today, I mean, Stephen could certainly pop in a written response if possible, but I'll pop that out to both of you.
I will come in just to say on your question that we haven't really been able to answer on international evidence of sort of that prevention. I will come back to you in writing on that, because I think there are some good examples we could point to, which it would be good to follow up on, because I think it's an area it'd be good to see more on in Scotland. So in terms of, yeah, looking at the longer term, I think it will be helpful for social security and long term look, because as both David and I said at the beginning, so demographic change tends to happen quite gradually, but we will see we're due to see sort of an aging of the average age of the population, and, you know, with resulting sort of the comorbidities that come with that, it may put more pressure on some of the benefits. So I think that will be useful, that really long-term outlook. But of course, it's obviously very uncertain when you're looking over that period of time. But for some of those kind of, you know, thinking about that core caseload, I think it will be quite helpful.
David, can we hear from you briefly? Thanks. Yep.
Yes, just to add, I actually was speaking to the Scottish Fiscal Commission on Monday about their plans for this report, and lessons that can be learned from the UK Fiscal Sustainability Report, some analysis that we did at the IFS a few years ago. I actually think it's a really good thing that they'll be doing. I can completely understand why they've hired several new people to look at it, because I think the kind of complexities of doing it for Scotland are even more than doing it for the UK, because one doesn't just need to kind of project forward, you know, if you like, Scottish revenues and Scottish spending pressures.
and also needs to project forward what happens in the rest of the UK and how the UK government responds to that because of Scottish government funding, depending on UK government responses. We have some very useful talks about what can be done there. So I actually think this is a really good development. I think Social Security will be an important part of those projections, as will, you know, other sort of services expected to kind of, you know, be strongly linked to demographics like health and social care. But I think it's a fantastic development.
Thank you very much for the answers to those questions from Marie. I'll move now to questions from Miles Briggs and then Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Convener. Just one quick question, because I think we've covered quite a lot with colleagues' questions. It was with regard to the work actually we've got after yourselves, and that's with the Minister with regards to uprating of benefits, and specifically the Scottish Government has announced six social security benefits will be uprated by 6% from the 1st of April. Now, given the cost of living pressures which we're seeing, I just wondered if that is the direction of travel around uprating, what sort of cost does that present for the basket of Scottish social security benefits, and what additional pressures do you think that will have in the coming years? Maybe start with Emma on that one.
Yeah, so I saw that announcement just before coming into committee. Sorry, I don't have time to run the numbers, but you could ask the Minister for that information. You see him shortly, but he'll thank me for that. Clearly it will be... it's come quite late on in the process, but I won't make a comment particularly on whether it, you know... I'm not here to say whether it's a good thing or a bad thing. I think it recognises particular pressures at the moment and some quite exceptional circumstances. I wouldn't expect it to set a precedent particularly to move away from using September as the reference month for uprating of benefits, as is usually the case. I think it is just it's a one-off because of quite particular exceptional issues at this moment in time. But of course, there are a lot more uncertainties in the macro economy than in the global economy than we've had for many years. So inflation could be very bumpy for a number of years. So potentially we do need to think about how to ensure that uprating policy is able to capture that rather than just choosing 1 month in a year and assuming inflation is generally kind of stable across that period. So yeah, it's as I say, the announcement only just came out this morning. So I'm not sure if the UK government will also follow suit. I don't think there's been any announcements made on that, but I think it is it's necessary. I think for many people in terms of being able to have their incomes from Social Security keep up with the cost of living. But it does, of course, have pressures on the budget, no doubt about that.
Thank you. And David, do you have anything you want to add? If not, I can hand back.
Just very quickly, I think, colleagues at the IFS have highlighted the particular difficulties around, uprating with past inflation at a time of very volatile inflation. I think, whether or not it will represent a change, there are opportunities to change this, at a UK level or a Scottish level. We have inflation forecasts. Inflation forecasts could be used to set benefit rates in a forward-looking way. I think what I would try to avoid is, like a benefits lock, where they kind of go up by the sort of maximum of forecast or past inflation. We've seen with the pensions triple lock that those sort of systems can lead to ratchet effects and substantially push up spending. So I mentioned that because, for example, if inflation, if it goes up by more than sort of past inflation, to take account that inflation is now higher in April, well, come September, inflation in the coming September is likely to be quite a bit higher than what it will be in the subsequent year. So one might want to kind of think about this as kind of like smoothing and accounting for the effect of actual inflation rather than necessarily leading to a permanent uplift in the rates of benefits. So I think the point I'm trying to make is that there's there's sense in thinking about how we uprate benefits in a way that makes it more responsive to inflation, but doesn't make it just responsive in one direction, that it's responsive in both directions. Otherwise, you could have an unintended upwards ratchet effect on benefit rates, and hence the cost of benefits. If you want to increase benefit generosity, that should be an active policy decision, not the sort of unintended consequence of a sort of well-meaning but you know, not particularly well-designed sort of policy like triple locks or double locks or so on.
That's interesting. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you very much. In the interest of time, can I ask members now to group your questions together that you have remaining? We haven't actually really rigidly stuck to the themes as we set them out anyway. So I'll ask Jeremy Balfour to start us off, and then I'll go to Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Convener. I have two questions. So first one's aimed at David. David, I was interested about your issue about tapering in regard to some benefits. I wonder, can you point us to any evidence of tapering across other parts of the world in regard to things like PIP and DLA, in regard to the new benefit coming here in Scotland? There's been quite a lot of research to say, why should I get better if I'm going to lose my benefit? So if I can suddenly walk 20 metres or 25 metres, I lose the car, so what's the benefit of me getting any better? Is there any evidence of tapering across the world in regard to things like PIP, which we could look at here in Scotland?
That's a really interesting question. When you mentioned tapering, I was thinking you were mentioning tapering in relation to income, and I was going to kind of say that, of course, these are not income-based benefits. These are sort of benefits based on need, and tapering would make it sort of, you know, less generous. But you're kind of mentioning a point, I think, about tapering in respect to health needs. And to some extent, there is some tapering in there with the sort of different rates, you know, of support, you know. So you have, like, you know, high, you know, higher and lower rates depending on the severity of your needs, on the different elements of things. One option would be to actually increase the number of these different, you know, standards of benefits, so that, you know, you can potentially, you know, move, you know, up or down these things in a more graduated way. And then the risk, you know, that would make it, you know, less of a kind of big change. If your health changes, you know, modestly, I think the kind of the risk with that is, with more sort of boundaries between benefit rates, you'd have, you know, more potential for sort of disagreement about which potential benefit rates someone should go on. It could open up, you know, the floodgates to sort of potentially lots more kind of disputes about benefit rates. And then the other option, you know, which I know is done in some other benefits, is to basically have a sort of time taper, maybe even a time taper as well, whereby you remove, you know, rather than as soon as your health condition changing, you get the benefit taken off you immediately, you have a you know, a phased withdrawal of the benefit. I must say, I'm not an expert on international benefit systems. Maybe Emma can say more about this. But I think the idea of saying that actually we're not going to withdraw the money straight away, we'll withdraw it in stages so that you can kind of adjust to your changes in circumstances, that's actually potentially a good idea. It would come with costs, but that would, you know, both smooth the adjustments in people's income, and potentially make it, you know, less of a concern, as you say, about people kind of being concerned about the incentives around taking actions to improve health. I know there's been schemes like that for in-work benefits. So for lone parents, there were schemes where lone parents could keep more of their benefits when they went into work, precisely so they didn't kind of think there wasn't that incentive to go into work, because they got to keep the benefits for at least a period of time whilst they're in work. So those schemes do exist for other benefits, or they have for other benefits in the UK. I don't know about disability benefits internationally. Maybe Emma knows about that.
No, apologies. I don't have anything further to add there. Again, I'm not an expert on international benefit systems.
Okay, thank you. I mean, that is helpful. It's quite interesting one to think about whether you could have a timetable in. So, anyway, moving on to my final question. And that is the fiscal framework, which is a mystery to most of us. However, obviously, there is negotiations going on around the fiscal framework at the moment between UK Government and Scottish Government. I suppose my question is around Social Security. How important is this negotiation going? And if you were advising Scottish Government, what would you be asking for?
And who do you direct that to first?
I am happy for Emma to start, if she wants to.
Yeah, of course. I think David will give a fuller answer on this, but there are a couple of specifics in terms of some of the issues that I'm aware of with the fiscal framework and Social Security. So firstly, I think it is really important that Social Security is a full part of any talks and renegotiations on this, because I think up until now it's quite often very much focused on income tax and Social Security is less is less understood, I think, in the context of the fiscal framework. But a particular issue that I want to raise is around the issues with spillover, because this does come up quite a lot in terms of development when thinking about developing changes to Social Security, so the transferred benefits, the extent to which there will be implications in terms of spillover, so that a change in Scotland leads to additional spending in the reserved system, and then that money is requested back from the Scottish Government by the Treasury. The issue I think we have at the moment is there's so much uncertainty over when spillover rules would apply. And there hasn't really been a test case necessarily of it. The only one that I know has been raised and resolved is in relation to where, if the Scottish Child Payment led to an increase in uptake on Universal Credit, would that be a spillover? As far as I understand, written submissions to the Parliament has confirmed that the Treasury would not view that to be the case. But in terms of things like, I think, the replacement for carers allowance in particular, there are a lot of concerns, very valid concerns that may lead to spillover impacts in terms of some of the way that's used as a passported benefit in the reserved system. And it would be good for there to be more understanding of how those issues are resolved and resolved quickly within policy development, because I think it does it is constraining the speed at which things can be considered and the understanding of the implications, not just for civil servants working on this, but also for those of us outside of government who are trying to, potentially look at the implications and not necessarily advise, but look at the issues that are on the table. And, it's where there's so much uncertainty about spillovers, that's quite difficult to do. So, and these issues can linger and not be, and if they're not resolved, then they kind of put a bit of a halt sometimes on scrutiny and indeed policy making. So that's a particular issue, but I'll refer to David for...
David, just before you come in, I am conscious of time and I understand this is a big issue. So you could maybe put some of this in writing to us. But my specific question for you, David, is in regard to any divergence in benefit criteria going forward. Can this be reflected within any negotiation? So if in a year's time, 18 months' time, the Scottish Government or the Parliament decide to increase the mobility to, say, 50 metres rather than 20, and thus more people will get that, should that be reflected within the fiscal framework now, or is that something that's just simply impossible to do?
Well, as I said in my answer to an earlier question, I think it's vitally important that the Scottish Government bears the cost of its own policies. So I don't think it would be appropriate in the fiscal framework to have a mechanism by which, in effect, the block grant increases to help Scotland pay for benefit changes that it wants to make itself. In the long run, the only way to fund increased spending, unless it does generate further savings in other areas, is to have higher taxes or to spend less elsewhere. As I said, I do think there is a role for the fiscal framework to potentially provide some additional flexibility in the short term. So in a report with David Bell and David Iser, we did recommend enhanced borrowing reserve powers. Some of that was for forecast errors. Some of that was saying actually there should be some discretionary resource borrowing, you know, potentially limited, you know, to around, you know, £400 million a year, about 1% of the budget, at least initially, given the wider UK fiscal kind of framework. But that would give, you know, time for Scotland to, you know, make changes to benefits and also kind of, you know, then plan, you know, how to fund them, you know, over space several years, not having to do it immediately. And that would, I think, give the kind of flexibility that Em was talking about. At the moment, because the fiscal framework really does restrain borrowing, you've got to kind of find the money, you know, straight away for policy measures. I think the fiscal framework could give additional flexibility of a modest degree to kind of make you know, policy a bit smoother in that area. I can forward you, in terms of, you know, follow-on comments, I can forward you potentially some information after the session.
I'm done.
Thank you very much for that. I'm going to ask the members that have remaining questions, because we are over time, to get their questions onto the record. So I'm going to ask them to ask them, and then I'll ask both of you if you can perhaps submit in writing answers to those questions. So we do have some questions from Faisal Chowdhury, from Pam Duncan-Glancy, and from Emma Roddick. So if we can get them on the record, that would be fantastic, and then we can get answers in writing. So, Faisal.
Thank you, Convener. I guess my question is to both of you, Emma and David. How is it possible to plan for 6 years ahead, given the current levels of economic and price volatility?
Do you have another one, just because we're going to get them to answer them in writing? Okay, thanks very much for that, Faisal. And Pam, if you can ask yours.
Thank you, Convener. My questions were around the child poverty target specifically, and you've said in submissions that it's unclear from the medium-term financial strategy or any other documents so far how the spending choices will progress towards meeting those targets. So it would be helpful if you could set out whether you believe the spending choices of the government will meet the child poverty targets. Also, your view on whether it will meet them for the target specific priority groups. And finally, what you would expect to see in the spending review from the government in order to meet the child poverty targets.
Thanks very much for that, Pam. I think that those are great questions that we need to have their answers to. And Emma, finally, yours.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I had a question around child poverty. I think that we expect reducing child poverty will create budget savings in other areas, but it is hard to solidly link underspends or reduced spends elsewhere to a reduction in child poverty. So are there ways that you can suggest to monitor those effects as good as possible, and how can we evidence knock-on effects and evaluate success on that level? My other question was around the fiscal framework review. I think it's fair to say that a hybrid social security model comes with a lot of challenges. We hear a lot about the limitations on future planning due to threat of changes to the block grant, extra costs of diverging from UK policy and so on. Does having a hybrid reserved and devolved social security system make financial sense? And can we ever protect the social security budget from risks effectively while we're so intrinsically tied to UK policy decisions?
Thank you very much for those questions, Emma. And I would like to thank witnesses for coming in today. And we do look forward to receiving your written submissions to those final remaining questions, because I think the answers to them will really help us in our role as the committee. Thank you very much. So I will suspend briefly for a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Thank you. And that's us back after a brief suspension. We're now going to consider agenda item number 3, which is subordinate legislation. We're going to consider the Social Security Uprating Scotland Order 2022. We were also due to consider the Social Security Uprating Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2022 at this morning's meeting, but the committee received a letter from the Minister yesterday which explained that the Miscellaneous Amendment Regulations are due to be withdrawn and relayed. Hopefully the Minister will be able to provide some information with regards to that this morning. So I welcome to the meeting Ben McPherson, Minister for Social Security and Local Government. The Minister is also joined online by Scottish Government officials. We have Simon Coote, who's the head of Cross-Cutting Policy Unit, Camilo Arredondo, solicitor, and Dominic Mellon, economic advisor, social security analysis. So I'll invite the Minister to make an opening statement. Minister.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, colleagues. First of all, I would like to offer my sincere thanks to you and the committee for accommodating the last-minute changes to the scrutiny process for the Social Security Uprating Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2022, which it had been the intention for us to also discuss today. As the convener has alluded to, the committee will be aware of the cost of living pressures, which have grown significantly since we took the decision on uprating benefits some time ago as part of the Scottish budget process. We know that these pressures may yet rise further, and we know that they will disproportionately impact the poorest households. That is why I took the decision to see what more could be done to support people using our social security powers. And in response, I am now seeking to use the uprating regulations to provide that additional support, which will primarily help low-income families and unpaid carers. In order to do that, it is necessary to withdraw the previous regulations and relay them under expedited procedures, which I am doing today. Please accept my apologies for any inconvenience this causes. However, I am sure you and the committee, and more widely, will understand the reasons why, and I hope sincerely that you will support them. I understand the committee will now consider those regulations on the 31st of March. But given the interest the committee will have, I think it's worth broadly outlining the changes that have been made now. And of course, I'm happy to come back later in the month if the committee wishes me to do so. I am now proposing additional support by further increasing several forms of devolved social security benefits and assistance from the previous 3.1% increase to the 6% rate. This will apply to Jobstart payment, young carers grant and funeral support, and subject to parliamentary approval, uprating will now be almost doubled for these benefits. Best Start grant will also be increased by 6%, and we will bring forward future regulations which will also affect the increase to the carers allowance supplement. We will also now increase child winter heating assistance by 6%, greater than the 5% already proposed, supporting 19,000 families of severely disabled children with heating costs. As the committee is aware, we have already taken the decision to double the Scottish Child Payment from £10 to £20 a week, a 100% increase, which will immediately benefit around 111,000 children. We increased Best Start Foods in August 2021 from £4.25 to £4.50 a week, a 5.88% rise, which exceeds the rate of inflation and is close to the 6% up rate for other benefits, so there is no change to that benefit. Turning now to the immediate task in hand, the committee is today considering the Social Security Uprating Scotland Order 2022. This uprates benefits for which we have executive competence, but which are currently administered by DWP under agency agreement on Scottish Ministers' behalf. Convener, this is important. We have no discretion around the level of uprating of these benefits. The agency agreements in place with the Secretary of State for Work and Pensions, which allow DWP to deliver these benefits on behalf of Scottish Ministers, mean that we are committed to uprate these benefits at the same rate as DWP. They are therefore uprated by 3.1% in line with the September CPI. It is, though, a matter for the Scottish ministers to make an order affecting the uprating, which is what you see before you today. I would like to thank the committee again for its scrutiny of the uprating order and its forbearance around the need for urgent changes to the uprating regulations. And I look forward to any questions the committee may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister, and thank you for providing that clear and concise explanation of why we will be looking at relayed regulations. And I think given the pressures that households are feeling across the country right now, I think that that will be a welcome decision for us to make on the 31st. As of today, do any members have any questions? Jeremy Balfour.
Good morning. Good morning, Minister, and good morning to your officials. Obviously, we will look at this on the 31st of March, I think you said, which is fine. I just wondered, so that we can look ahead with appropriate planning, with the increase in regard to these benefits, presumably that cost will be met out of Scottish Government budget rather than from what has already been planned. I'm just wondering, where is that money coming from? Is it going to come from the Social Security budget that was approved by the Parliament, or is it coming from a different budget from a different department? When we passed the budget, we were told by Kate Forbes that, you know, every penny had been accounted for, every money had been spent. So this is obviously extra money that wasn't in the budget. I'm just wondering, where is this money coming from?
I think that's an important question without meaning to get overly detailed into the complexities of the internal correspondence within government, although I'll bring Dominic in after me for anything further that he may wish to add that's relevant. But we have, of course, collectively as ministers looked at the situation before us of the real pressures that families are encountering and going to encounter in the period ahead, and we are determined to provide assistance and help where we can and using the powers and resources that we have. So we have looked at what we could absorb within the Social Security budget. The additional amount that we are allocating in the financial year ahead is £2.7 million. So in order to undertake the uprating. So we have absorbed that within the Social Security budget.
And will that mean that there will be any other... I suppose what I'm trying to work out is where is that £2.7 million coming from? So was it sitting there for a rainy day, or had it been allocated for a different purpose and is now being transferred, you know, probably quite rightly, to this? I'm just trying to work out how much flexibility do you have within your budget for this?
So budgets are always have a degree of flexibility, and we have decided to this will involve considering the cross pressures in the course of the financial year, but we have come to the position that we feel we can absorb a £2.7 million increase.
And my final question, Camino, is does this have any knock-on effect for other things that you might have been thinking about in this financial year? So you might have been thinking we could maybe be a bit more generous here, or we could maybe think about this benefit there. Is that now being put on the back shelf because you're bringing this money forward fairly early on within this financial year?
It is not our intention that this will have an impact, particularly on those accessing Social Security. We have decided to consider this, as I said, as an absorbed cost and pressure within the Social Security budget. Dominic or Simon, I don't know if you want to add anything to that that may be helpful and appropriate.
There'd be nothing for me, Minister. I'm not sure if Simon has anything further to add.
It looks to me like they're both, everybody's frozen there for a little while. I don't know if anybody did have anything. Nope.
Thank you, Minister. And thank you, Camino.
Thank you very much. I understand that Faisal Chowdhury has a question. Faisal.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, Ben. Sir Minister. I don't know if I missed it or not, but carer's allowance supplement was going to be kept at its higher rate after COVID. Did this just fall by the wayside?
So, as I said in my opening statement, the carers' allowance supplement will be uprated by 6%. In terms of the carers' allowance supplement additional payment, which, of course, we passed legislation on just a number of months ago, that is a point of consideration for the government ongoing into the period ahead, and I'm sure we will discuss that with the committee and indeed in the chamber and at points in the months ahead. But I can confirm that the carers allowance supplement will be uprated by 6%.
Thank you much. Pam, did you want to come in as well? Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for allowing me to take the question. I know I indicated in advance that I may not have one. I just wonder, I have two questions, if that's okay, for the Minister. Obviously that we face a considerable cost of living crisis right now, and I believe this is well-meaning and the right thing to do. We heard this morning that the IFS said the same, that they said it was well-meaning but not well-designed, the way that you've done this. I do worry slightly that on Thursday, the papers that we got for this committee suggested that you were going to replicate, and in fact, in not some areas, you weren't going to uprate at all. So can you set out what's changed between Thursday and today to take you to this decision? Not because I think it's the wrong one, but because I'm keen to know that, that we're taking decisions properly, with robust information and in a considered fashion. And then my next question is around the benefits that we are being asked to uprate today around the CPI 3.1% that are still being delivered under agency agreement. I guess it's maybe not so much a question, more of a statement to put on record that, again, it's another frustration of mine that we could have been doing something a bit differently had we been fully delivering these benefits in Scotland. And what you've done in other areas shows, or what you intend to do on the 31st of March in other areas, shows what we could have been doing for disabled people and carers had we not been using agency agreements still at this stage.
So I'll come to those two points in turn. Of course, the regulations that were based on the September CPI followed the position that had been undertaken in years past since we introduced the social security benefits to operate on that basis. The rising cost of living pressures that we've seen both pre the invasion of Ukraine and since, of course, have changed the situation for all of us and for families affected in particular. In lower-income households and unpaid carers. So, as a government, we're committed to doing the right thing and helping people where we can. So we looked carefully at this situation. We looked at what we could do with our powers, what we could do with our resources, and we've done what's necessary to make sure that we can deliver this uprating. With regard to the point in terms of the Social Security benefits that are delivered under agency agreement, and because we can't create a two-tier system, because we have people in the Scottish system and people in the reserve system until they transfer into the Scottish system, particularly those on disability benefits. You know, I appreciate the position of Pam Duncan-Glancy, but you know, this government is moving at pace to undertake the delivery of devolved social security and to transfer in a safe and secure way people into our system. We had a pandemic, and we're still in a pandemic, it made it challenging for us to do that to our original timetable. The timetables needed to change, not just for the Scottish Government, but for the DWP. I think the fact that Social Security Scotland is about to launch its 12th benefit on Monday, seven of which are new, is pretty remarkable in the period that we've had since 2018. And you know, we're building an institution here, an organisation that needs to be strong, not just in the period ahead, but for years to come. And that relies on building a strong foundation. So in an ideal world, would we have everyone in our system as you know, quicker than has happened? Of course, but this takes time. You know, it's not like we just get a USB stick from DWP and plug it into our computer. It's a much more complicated process than that, and we're undertaking it with diligence and responsibility.
Could I make one further comment, please? Also, just to correct the record, I said that we got our papers on Thursday. We didn't. We would have got them on Monday. Forgive me, I was getting confused with which committee papers I was describing. I thank you for that answer. I thank the Minister for the answer. And respectfully suggest that I don't suggest this is about a USB stick transferring information at all. We've had since 2018 at least to get moving on this, and so there is still a considerable amount of time passed. And I know the Minister understands that. I also understand that it is complex, but we could have been operating disability benefits and carers' benefits by 6% today, and we're not. And I just want to mark on the record that I think that's unfortunate that we've not been able to take that decision, because we're still not delivering those benefits here in Scotland for the people of Scotland.
I respect Pamela Glancy, of course, highly, but I would just emphasise again that, you know, we've built an agency from scratch since 2018 that's highly performing, employs nearly 2,000 people, and we have delivered several benefits. We'll deliver our 12th on Monday, start delivering our 12th on Monday, and seven of those benefits are new and only available in Scotland, some of which we're discussing operating today.
For that, Minister. I can see from the chat that Simon might want to come in. I don't know if you want to bring him in.
Please go ahead, Simon.
There seems to be a delay. Yep, go ahead, Simon. Thank you. Oh, Simon, we can't hear you. No, we still can't hear you. I'll actually go to a question from Miles Briggs, and then we'll try and see if we can get Simon back in.
Thank you, Convener. We've had a good run without gremlins being in the system, really, with this committee. Morning, Minister. Good morning to your officials as well. I wanted to ask, you've outlined the £2.7 million, which you've identified in this year's flexibility to do this. Has there been any other money also identified which potentially, as this cost of living crisis goes forward, there would be flexibility to come back to committee on?
As the member knows, there's significant pressure on the Scottish budget for the financial year ahead across the portfolio, and the Finance Secretary has emphasised that many times to Parliament. We have, as I said, identified this resource that we can absorb within our budget. We continually look to see where we can use resource efficiently and for the benefit of the people of Scotland on a regular basis. We've had to work hard to internally to identify this resource and make it available. But we're glad that we've been able to do that. I'm not at this point going to specify or able to specify if there will be other resource available in the course of the financial year. Of course, as the member will know, budget is allocated and then we go through the process of the financial year, and there's reconciliations and reconsiderations of positions. But what I can emphasise is that throughout the process of the next financial year, just as the Scottish Government always does, just as all ministers and myself and the Cabinet Secretary and Social Security do on a consistent basis, we look at what resources available and how we can utilise that to help the people of Scotland, and particularly to help low-income households and unpaid carers with regard to Social Security.
Thank you for that. I suppose the key point I'm trying to get at is this looking at potential unrealised additional take-up or unmet need, for example, and where's your projections on that? Because I think most people would expect more people potentially to seek some of these social security benefits. So I'm just wondering, in terms of that spend, where this is being targeted, and if we do see additional people coming forward, where that flexibility has potentially now been lost.
There's no loss of flexibility in that regard, in that we set budget allocation on projections, and of course that involves the Scottish Fiscal Commission, but also we project on the fact that we will also be encouraging people to uptake benefits, and you'll know both in the legislation of the 2018 Act and in Scottish Government policy intention and documentation that we are strongly committed to promoting benefit take-up and to undertaking what's necessary. And you know, we've had good discussions at this committee on how collectively we can all play our part in promoting benefit take-up. And I think that becomes even more pertinent in the period ahead. And I just call again on all members to work with the government and to work with the different public bodies involved in that collaborative effort to raise awareness in communities of what support is available, encourage people to apply if they think they might be eligible, and to tell their friends and their neighbours about it so that we can spread the word of what support is there. And of course some of the benefits that we would be promoting are some of the ones that I've set out today that we intend to operate by 6%.
Okay, I appreciate that. I think what would be useful, and I don't know if the Minister would commit to that, in terms of our financial scrutiny as a committee, to be able to also see some of this potential flexibility within budgets. I don't know if you had a chance to see the previous session we just had, but you know, I think there is a lot of work around what is approaching a £750 million future projection, and where we can have oversight of more information on that, I think would be helpful for the work we're trying to do.
I did see some of the previous session. Certainly happy to have correspondence, of course, with the committee on these important points that Mr. Briggs raises. I think that there would be a question for the committee. You know, this is not just a question for Social Security ministers, but also for the finance portfolio and how the committee may want to consider those points.
Okay. Thank you, Kavina.
Thank you very much for that, Minister. And I think that that's something that the committee would maybe have a dialogue with you you about. It looks like Simon left and came back in and would like to perhaps try again. So I'll bring Simon in before I move to Marie McNair, who's online, who has a question. Simon? Oh, Simon, we still don't have any volume from you. Unfortunately, I think perhaps we maybe have to come back with that in writing, unfortunately. Could I please move to Marie McNair, who's remote with her question?
Thanks, convener, and good morning, Minister. From your letter to the presiding officer, you're aware that in light of the cost of living crisis, you plan to bring forward the emergency legislation that will increase the uplift to 6% for Scottish benefits, and it's really welcome. And it will help some people, you know, cope with the impact that the crisis is, you know, having on household incomes. You set that out. It's not possible for disability benefit because of the current welfare uprating of Westminster uprating policy. But the Resolution Foundation has asked that the UK Government to uprate higher for many benefits as administratively possible, but at least UC and tax credits, and this could include DWP disability benefits. It would be an obvious way to assist with the cost of living crisis. I haven't seen any, you know, remote possibility they're going to do this. Is that also your understanding of their position?
Thanks, Marie McNair, for those important questions. I think certainly we've had no indication from either UK ministers in the DWP or the Treasury of an intention for them to uprate above the September CPI of 3.1%. Of course, we would encourage them to do so. I think the signal that you know, we've set our intention and our determination in the regulations that we are now laying to operate the Social Security benefits, the six Social Security benefits that we can fully determine up by 6%, and of course we're increasing the Scottish Child Payment by 100%. So we're doing what we can with the powers and resources that we have to provide assistance, and I would encourage the UK Government to also do the right thing and operate Social Security benefits across the UK, and particularly in the areas where there's the current dual process of delivery and introduction by the Scottish Government and case transfer with regard to disability benefits, so in particular child disability payment and adult disability payment. So I would encourage the UK government to increase PIP and disability living allowance for working age adults up above 3.1%, and then also to look at universal credit again. I think the case to increase universal credit and the other benefits that they control is compelling, and I hope they'll do the right thing in the, mm-hmm. the March statement.
Thanks for that clarification, Minister.
Thank you very much for that. Before we move into the formal part of the session, I'll bring Pam Duncan-Glancy back in with a final question. Pam.
Thank you, Convener. Has the Minister considered any other ways or mechanisms where you could apply the equivalence of the 6% uprate to disabled people in Scotland or carers who receive carers allowance in Scotland? Have you looked at any other mechanisms that could be used to get that money into people's pockets?
I'm not fully clear on the specifics of Pam Duncan-Glancy's question, so I hope this generic answer will suffice, but please let me know if you have any further points. But I mean, in terms of cost of living support, of course we've taken the action with regard to the council tax position in terms of the action that Ms Forbes took just a number of weeks ago. We have the council tax reduction scheme, the Scottish Welfare Fund, which of course we are still significantly investing in, the mitigation that we're undertaking with regard to the bedroom tax, which of course costs us tens of millions of pounds a year. So there's a number of different measures already in place to support as much as we can. I think the advantage of Social Security is, of course, it allows us to, with the system that we have, which I know that all of the committee supports, with the devolved Social Security system, we can get money to people and into their pockets, and that's the real advantage of one having that system and continuing to develop it in a really coherent and strong way for the period ahead and decades to come.
Okay, thanks.
Minister, so I will remind committee that only members and the Minister may take part in the formal debate, and I invite the Minister to move the motion S6M03002 that the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recommends that the Social Security Uprating Scotland Order 2022 be approved.
Formally moved.
Thank you very much, Minister. Do any members have anything that they wish to add on top of their questions before, which are on the record? Nope, not seeing any indications. As no member wishes to speak in the debate, I will put the question on the motion. The question is that motion SM6-03002 be approved. Are we all agreed? Thank you. We are all agreed. The motion is therefore approved. I invite the committee to agree that the clerks and I will produce a short factual report of the committee's decisions and arrange to have it published. Okay, agreed. Thank you very much. That does conclude the committee's public meeting this morning. I thank the Minister and his officials. Even if we had some gremlins and we couldn't actually hear from the officials for their evidence this morning. And I now invite members who are joining us remotely to leave this meeting and join the private session. And I suspend for that. Thank you very much.